This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
Those who weren't here earlier in the course, my name is Bobby Barron. I'm the director of this particular course and also director of the UCSF Osher Mini Medical School program. So on behalf of all of us, let me welcome you again. This week, as part of our nutrition course, we're going to focus on blood fats, blood lipids. So we've entitled the talk, Dietary Fats, the Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. And you've met our speaker, Katie Ferraro. Katie is an assistant professor at UCSF in the School of Nursing and also at the University of San Diego in the School of Nursing. And she now lives primarily in San Diego and was kind enough to come up here for both of these lectures. So she may not have mentioned that, but be sure to give her a particularly loud round of applause for that heroic effort. As you know, she's working on a textbook that will be published by McGraw-Hill soon. And probably most remarkably, at least recently, has led one of the first completely online nutrition courses worked collaboratively by UCSF and a company called Coursera, which is working now with many leading universities to move a lot of our content to an online format. This mini med school is also online, will be available online. It's broadcast on local television and also is online indefinitely through University of California Television. But the Coursera courses are much more interactive and a real opportunity to mimic what goes on in the classroom online, and really represents the future of education and including the future of health professions education. So, for those of you who want to learn more about basic nutrition, even than what we've been able to teach in these 6 weeks, please join Katie for her course. So again, we've entitled the talk, Dietary Fats, the Good, Bad, and the Ugly. Please join me in welcoming back Katie Ferraro.
Thank you, Dr. Barron, and thank you again for having me back. You're also welcome that I brought the beautiful weather from San Diego up here today. These are the days when I look at the weather and I say, I can't believe I don't live in San Francisco anymore. And I used to tell people that I left San Francisco because I was tired of paying California prices and not getting California weather. But then every time I come back and it's this beautiful weather, it kind of, you know, puts that to rest. But I'm happy to be here with you today to talk about dietary fats. We're going to focus, we hear so many bad things about fat. And so today I really want to show you the ways that we can use fat to help improve our overall nutrition and health profile. So last week our focus was on fiber, you know, that very powerful nutrient that we all can pretty much stand to eat more of. With regards to fat, I'm not here to convince you to eat less fat, but rather to convince you to increase the types of healthy fats that you have in your diet. And to show you a little bit about the different types of dietary fats in the foods that we eat, and then how that affects our health profile, and in particular, our risk for heart disease. So just as a brief overview, today we're gonna cover, as you said, the good, the bad, and the ugly. We're gonna start with the bad though, the saturated and the trans fats. We'll move on to talking about the unsaturated fats. Perhaps you've heard of monounsaturated and polyunsaturated fats. We'll discuss dietary cholesterol, answering some of the age-old questions. You know, what's better for me, butter or margarine? Or are eggs good or bad for me? I want to answer those questions based on what the current evidence and research shows us about the effects of these foods in our diet. We'll talk about essential fatty acids and primarily the role that omega-3 fatty acids can play in helping to reduce inflammation. And then we'll leave by focusing on the Mediterranean diet, a topic that's been around for generations, but recently has become very prominent in the news because of a number of large-scale studies. So I want to show you how you can take the benefits or the components of the Mediterranean diet and hopefully help reduce your overall disease risk profile. At the end, I'll leave you with what I hope are some practical tips for you to develop your own nutrition prescription with regards to fat. How much fat should you eat? How much cholesterol? And what sources in the diet should those nutrients be coming from? So let's go ahead and just start with a little bit of overview regarding fats. As Dr. Barron said, we often refer to fats as what are called lipids. So if you're at your cardiologist and he says, I want to test your blood lipids, essentially what that means is we're going to be looking at the level of fat in your blood. Lipid is the chemical term for fat. Now lipids, as we said, they get a bad rap sometimes. You hear about people wanting to adopt a low-fat diet for X or Y reason. But I do want to point out the many beneficial things that fat does for our body. The primary focus of today's talk is about fat in the diet, but fat does a lot of good things for our body. Fat pads our organs. I like to think of the analogy, if you were riding a horse and you did not have internal fat to pad your organs during that horse ride would slam into each other and you would no longer be a viable entity. Fat is very, very important. Too much fat, not a good thing around our organs, and we'll get into that today, but it does provide that padding. It also insulates the body. If you've ever worked with or known someone who has the eating disorder, anorexia nervosa, so an intense fear of fat characterized by severe calorie restriction, these people are very, very underweight and they have essentially very little body fat. As a result, the body's overall temperature reduces. And an interesting phenomenon occurs in that that individual actually starts to grow excessive body hair. Not in the way you would think of it, like around the face, et cetera, but particularly around the arms, you notice it. It's an extra peach fuzz-like layer of hair. And if you think about it, that's the body's way of basically growing its own sweater to try to keep your body temperature warmer because of that lack of body fat. So we need a baseline amount of body fat in order to maintain an appropriate temperature. Fat also plays a role in every single cell in your body. Fat is an essential part of every cell membrane. Again, using the unfortunate experience of people who have anorexia nervosa, one of the clinical or physical manifestations of this very debilitating condition is that the individuals have very weak nails and skin and hair because the cell membranes of basically every part of their body are suffering due to inadequate dietary fat, which in turn leads to unhealthy cell membrane structures in the body. So what we eat truly does affect our body. Now, with regards to food, lipids or fats play a very important role. They contribute texture to foods. You've all probably had a low-fat cookie or a low-fat brownie, and even without packaging, you taste that. You know it's low-fat because it has that spongy texture, and we miss that really good, what we call, mouthfeel that fat contributes. And food manufacturers are experts at studying the effect of fat on mouthfeel. And that we as humans, even when we do tests and studies in very little babies, we innately like the way that fat tastes and feels on our tongue. Fat also contributes aroma to foods. You know, when you're in the airport and you smell the wonderful cinnamon buns cooking, you're not smelling the sugar, you're actually smelling the fat. And there's a lot of research now that's going on about these different sensory reactions that we have to food. And we know that the smell of fat and the taste of fat are very powerful contributors to why we crave or want to eat high fat foods. Fats, as you see here, provide 9 calories per gram. That's interesting if you compare it to carbohydrates and proteins, which only contribute 4 calories per gram. Essentially, calories being energy, we can say that fat is twice as energy dense as are carbohydrates and proteins. So in simple terms, if you had a cookie that was 10 grams in weight and that was 100% fat, the 10 grams times the 9 calories per gram would mean that that cookie has 90 calories. Now, if you had a similar cookie in weight, looked the same, same size, same weight, but it was 10 grams of carb or 10 grams of protein, that cookie would only have 40 calories. Now, of course, we can't live on fat alone or carb alone or protein alone, but the very basic tenet behind some recommendations to follow a lower fat diet is that when you cut out the fat, you also cut back on your calories. Now, we like to say that a low-fat diet does not a low-fat person make. And if you think of the 1990s and the craze that we saw for low-fat foods, do you guys all remember the Snackwell's line of foods? There were fat-free cookies and fat-free cakes. We had fat-free, my favorite was fat-free Antoine's coffee cake. And if you think about what the typical ingredients are in a coffee cake, making a fat-free version of it, it's rather ridiculous. But consumers were learning low-fat's the way to go. But if you cut all the fat out and then replace it with an equal, if not greater, number of calories from sugar, those excess calories, of course, are going to contribute to weight gain. So despite an increase in the 1990s in the prevalence of non-fat and low-fat foods in our diet, as a nation, we actually got fatter. Because our bodies are incredibly unique in that we can store excess calories, whether they're from fat, carb, or protein, our body, if we consume too many of those, can convert all of that to body fat. So you can technically get quote unquote fat on a fat-free diet if you're eating too many calories and not exercising enough. The calories are from carb or protein or from alcohol. In the United States today, the typical diet is about 33% of the calories from fat. Now there's some interesting studies where we look at, you know, what we as a nation eat. And over the decades, the percentage of calories that Americans are eating from fat has gone down. But the total number of grams of fat that we are eating has gone up. And that is because, as a nation, over the decades, we eat more and more and more calories. So we're getting closer to reducing the percentage of calories from fat, but the problem is we're still eating too many calories, which in turn leads to those statistics that you see. Two-thirds of the country being overweight or obese. Now, as far as the overview of the classification of our fats goes, we're going to look primarily today at triglycerides. There are three primary types of fat: triglycerides, phospholipids, and sterols. Since 95% of the fat that we eat in our diet comes from triglycerides, that's what we're going to focus on today. But we also consume in very small portions phospholipids, which are types of fats that allow fats and water to mix together. You have a watery environment in your gut. The fat in your food needs to coalesce somehow and float through that watery environment. And phospholipids help us do that. Perhaps you've heard of the most well-known sterol, which is cholesterol. That's another classification of fat. And we'll talk briefly about cholesterol today, but we'll also note that things like vitamin D and your sex hormones, as well as cortisol, which is a stress hormone, are all types of sterols. So here's our friend, the triglyceride. Okay, without getting too deep into the chemistry of it, if we break down the term triglyceride, tri meaning three, you see three fatty acids that are attached to a glycerol backbone. Okay, so the glycerol backbone's on the right there, and the three fatty acids are there. We're going to look in a moment at how differences in those fatty acid chains from triglyceride to triglyceride affect our health. And we're also going to look, in addition to the length, we're going to look at the degree of saturation. So where do we find fat in our diet? You've heard the term good fats and bad fats. But fat is found in a variety of places throughout the food groups. Okay? We have our protein foods: meat, fish, poultry, legumes, seeds, eggs, and nuts. The meat industry, and particularly the cattlemen's group, they will spend a lot of money trying to convince you that you should eat more meat because it's an excellent source of protein. It certainly is. And it's an excellent source of iron and some other important minerals. But we do have to acknowledge that these animal foods that make up a good percentage of the protein that most Americans eat, are also quite high in fat. So we get protein from meats, but we also get fat. Very few foods that we eat have just one nutrient. They are a combination of lots of different nutrients. Dairy products and condiments have fat in them. I like to say, as we said with the fiber foods, if it's white, walk away. The white bread, the white potatoes, the white rice. If you're at risk for heart disease or you yourself have high cholesterol levels, with regards to condiments, I also advise you, if it's white, walk away. Sour cream, cream cheese, Caesar salad dressing, all those white, creamy condiments tend to be quite high in fat, and in particular, saturated fats, which you'll see in a moment are the ones we want to eat less of. We also have fruit-based fat. Most fruits are fat-free, with the exception of coconuts and avocados. And we'll focus today in a little bit when we talk about the Mediterranean diet about the role of avocados on health and some of the nutritional benefits that they can convey. And then, of course, there's added fats, oil, butter, and margarine. When you cook in your home kitchen, you can probably use a little bit of oil, butter, or margarine. But the reality is that the majority of Americans do not cook at home. They eat at restaurants, and they eat already prepared foods where there is extremely higher amounts of added fats than you would yourself put on that food at home. People go out to dinner and they say, I'm so good, I had fish for dinner last night instead of a steak. Oh, what'd the fish look like? Oh, it came out on this beautiful plate and it was just gleaming and glistening. And why would your fish be gleaming or glistening? Because it's doused in butter and probably a lot of oil, okay? More so than you would prepare it at home. Not to say fish is a poor choice, but we have to think about the added fats and oils that go into our foods, especially when we eat at restaurants. So the location of our fat matters. And I want to introduce the difference between visceral fat and subcutaneous fat. We'll start with visceral fat. This is what we refer to as the bad fat. This is also called intra-abdominal fat. And visceral fat is located within our abdomen. It basically is packed between and wraps around your organs, like your liver and your kidneys and your heart, etc. Having high amounts of visceral fat, let's look at that intra-abdominal fat that makes kind of like the beer belly appearance, we know that that type of fat, or having higher levels of that type of fat, increases your risk for heart disease and diabetes. And there's even convincing evidence coming out now that it can increase our risk for dementia. So your beer belly can actually be increasing your risk for getting dementia later in life. Now, subcutaneous fat, on the other hand, is the fat that sits closer to your skin. And so you might think of having subcutaneous fat in your buttocks or your thighs area. You might not like having fat there, but you should know that the subcutaneous fat is much less dangerous than is the visceral fat. We used to think that all fat was created equally. And even recently, as a few decades ago, researchers thought fat was inert, meaning it just sat there and didn't do a whole much. But we now know that fat in our bodies is actually metabolically active, and that it produces hormones and other compounds that can be affecting different areas of health. With regards to that visceral or intra-abdominal fat, that fat is considered to be dangerous in the sense that it leaches into our bloodstream rather easily and is metabolized in a way in your liver such that it works to elevate your bad levels of cholesterol. So that beer belly fat is significantly more dangerous than is the fat that you might have located in other areas of your body. And this is important for people who are trying to make positive changes in their diet. We encourage our patients and our clients here at UCSF and other health institutions not to just focus on the number on the scale. If you're overweight and you want to lose weight, then yes, weighing yourself on occasion is important. But it's also important to look at other outcomes, including what your waist circumference is. We'll mention a little bit later the metabolic syndrome. This is a cluster of risk factors that increases risk of disease. And one of the risk factors for metabolic syndrome is how wide around your waist is. Now, if you ask males and you ask females what their waist circumference is, males, of course, are much more in tune with their waist circumference because their pant size comes in inches. Women, on the other hand, have done an excellent job of extricating ourselves from having to ever know what our true waist size is, as we have sizes like 6 and 12 and things that don't really correlate to our inches. But for females, if you weigh yourself at the widest part around on your belly, if that number is above 35 inches, that's one of the risk factors for metabolic syndrome. So above 35-inch waist circumference indicates higher levels of visceral fat. For males, that number is 40. So if your waist circumference is higher than 40, that is also a risk factor. If you start changing your diet, and particularly if you start exercising more readily, one of the things people always say to me is, you know, I might not be losing weight as quickly as I'd hope to, and some of that might have to do with fat converting to muscle, but I do notice that my pants fit better. I can notch my belt one more belt loop in. And that's a really positive outcome in addition to losing weight, or something we should look at besides just the number on the scale. Because reduction in waist circumference, if you're above 35 inches for a female or 40 inches for a male, that's a really good thing that you're doing for yourself by reducing the amount of visceral fat that you're carrying around. There are some dietitians I know who actually do walk around with 5-pound models of fat. I don't know if anyone's ever seen that, but it's a very powerful tool. If you think of just something in your house that weighs 5 pounds, a 5-pound barbell or a 10-pound dumbbell, when you hold those, they're pretty convincingly heavy. And if you think that most people could stand to lose 10 or 20 pounds, initially, especially if you carry your weight in that abdominal area, that's the fat that kind of tends to come off first. And that's good fat to be losing. But I do want to mention that we have no conclusive evidence that any sort of spot exercising or spot reduction works. And sometimes you see these commercials on TV, if you buy this special contraption, you can concentrate on your belly fat. Belly fat diets are kind of all the rage right now. But you can't eat a certain way or exercise a certain way to lose weight in one particular region. You can exercise and do cardiovascular exercise, get your heart rate up, and lose weight overall. You'll tend to lose it more quickly in the abdominal region if that's where you carry your fat. But again, there's no one diet or no one exercise that will work on just losing weight in one area. A little bit of research regarding the location of body fat. We're looking at the Health, Aging, and Body Composition study. This was published in the journal Hypertension. And it was a study that looked at a sample size of 2,500 people who were aged 70 to 79. What the researchers found was that those who had more abdominal and visceral fat had stiffer arteries than those who had less fat. So even if you weren't, it didn't matter whether they were normal weight or overweight or obese by the different classifications, just the presence of having greater amounts of fat in that abdominal region actually increased the risk of atherosclerosis, which is the hardening of the arteries, which is a risk factor for or a component of heart disease. So any questions so far regarding location of fat or classification of fat? Okay, so the question is regarding body fat percentage, and is that related to the fat that you eat? I'm not going to cover that today. In sports nutrition, your percent body fat is definitely important. But with regards to the general population, there's kind of an unnecessary focus on percent body fat, not to mention that many of the ways we actually measure percent body fat are quite inaccurate. The gold standards for measuring percent body fat tend to be quite expensive. If you're interested in having that done, the DEXA bone scan, your doctor, especially if you're at risk for osteoporosis, might recommend DEXA, D-E-X-A. And while they recommend that to show you what your bone mineral density is, that also shows you what your percent body fat is. But those calipers, like you see at the gym, those are notoriously inaccurate. If you think about why, you know, the person at the gym wants you to feel kind of bad about your percent body fat so that you will then go to the gym, right? And those calipers, if they're used in research studies, if they're calibrated, if they're used by trained professionals, can be quite accurate, but more often than not, they're inappropriately used. So in the arenas that I work in, I really tell people not to worry about their percent body fat. There's more important markers and outcomes for the general population, but percent body fat for athletes would be relevant. Question? Okay, so the question is how, that's a great question. If you're normal weighted, how can you have abdominal fat? And have more or, well, because people carry fat in different areas. And there's an informal term we use. Have you ever met anyone who's, as we say, skinny fat? They look skinny, from the outside, and then sometimes you look at their belly and they're not fit. They're carrying around fat here, while overall they might be quote unquote normal weight. And because these weight categories are determined by your BMI, which is your body mass index, that's a function of the relationship between your weight and your height. So you could be really tall and really skinny all through here, but have a spare tire right here. In that case, the person might be considered normal weight as a function of their weight to height, but they actually are carrying some fat around that middle. Even if you're quote unquote normal weight, the presence of fat in this area is what the researchers found increased the risk of heart disease. Question? So the question is it possible to reduce abdominal fat if a person is 70 to 79? As mentioned, there's no recommended therapy for reducing just abdominal fat. But if that person is overweight, reducing all weight will help reduce that abdominal fat weight. And also, if the person is normal weight but they have fat in this area, doing weight training exercise throughout the body can help convert some of the fat to muscle. So the question is, with regards to sterols, if you eat more, will it increase your hormone levels? As far as I know, most of the research is about fat deficiency. And again, coming back to the anorexics, that individuals who have no fat in their diet and in turn no cholesterol tend to have lower levels of vitamin D and lower levels of sex hormones. But with regards to the cortisol and the stress hormones, I'm not sure how actual dietary intake, or I'm not aware of conditions whereby too much or too little directly affects that. But cortisol is affected by your sterol intake, but to what degree, I'm really not sure. So let's go ahead and look next at saturated fats. And we're gonna start out with the bad, okay? So when we think of saturated fats, a good way to remember that is, remember with the fiber, we said for soluble fibers, you think of S for soluble and S for sponge. Soluble fibers act like a sponge, and they soak up the bad cholesterol and take it out when we go to the bathroom. So I wanna eat more soluble fiber to help bring our bad cholesterol levels down. In the case of fats, you can think S for saturated and S for solid. Saturated fats tend to be solid at room temperature. Okay, so you have that nice, big, beautiful T-bone steak with the white marbling all through it and the nice strip of white around the outside. That fat that's solid when that steak is refrigerated or sitting on your counter, that's saturated fat. And contrary to public belief, when you cook that steak on the grill, that saturated fat does not all melt off and disappear. It melts into your meat. Okay? And so when we look for lower fat and lower saturated fat meats, we want to look at the fat or the meat and see, you know, how much of that white visible fat can we see before we cook it? Okay. Again, another reason to cook at home, because they don't let you see that steak before they cook it at the fancy restaurant. Other sources of saturated fat in the diet include meat, and we'll kind of explain the differences between lean meats and high-fat meats in a moment. Cheese, full-fat dairy, things like ice cream and butter, and then tropical oils, palm and coconut oils, but all added oils and fats like margarine, butter, etc. Contain some degree of saturated fat, some better than others, and I'll show you the comparison in a moment. So if we want to look at the chemical structure of saturated fats, the reason why they're called saturated is because if you'll note on the fatty acid chain here, every single space that could possibly be occupied by a hydrogen is occupied by a hydrogen. It's essentially saturated with hydrogens. There's no carbon-carbon double bonds. No room at the end. The entire thing is full of hydrogens. Okay? And I'll show you how that affects your health in a moment. But what's interesting about saturated fats is because they're straight chained, they stack very easily, and that's why they tend to become solidified at room temperature. As opposed to the mono and polyunsaturated fats, you'll see in a moment, they have double bonds that kind of cause their chains to be kinked, and they don't stack as nicely, and as such, the unsaturated fats are actually liquid at room temperature. Okay, so we want to watch out for the saturated or solid fats. Where do we get saturated fat in our diet? People say to me, okay, I'm at risk for heart disease. If there's anything I can cut out of my diet, I've got high cholesterol, what should I do? Two recommendations: cut back or cut out your meat, cut back or cut out your cheese. Meat and cheese are the two primary sources of saturated fat in a typical Western diet. Now, it might not be us sitting down to a hamburger with cheese on it every day, but you'll note from this list that meat and cheese features pretty heavily, especially meat, in a lot of these primary sources of saturated fat in the U.S. diet. And if you'll note, the top 10 sources of saturated fat in the diet are also foods that are devoid of fiber. So the higher the saturated fat intake, the lower the fiber we have in our diet. So the question is there a link between dietary cholesterol and blood cholesterol? And that's an excellent question, because if you have high blood cholesterol, it doesn't necessarily mean you need to stop eating dietary cholesterol. I'll explain dietary cholesterol in a second. But people think, okay, my blood cholesterol is high, I'm just gonna cut out cholesterol in my diet and call it a day. What's interesting though is that it's the saturated fat in your diet that raises your bad cholesterol and the trans fat, and I'll get to that next. But saturated and trans fats in your diet raise your bad cholesterol more than cholesterol in your diet does. Now, cholesterol in your diet, if you have a very high cholesterol diet, that can affect your blood cholesterol level too. But again, it's the saturated and the trans fats that more quickly, and we know, are more harmful. So if you have high cholesterol, the focus should be on reducing these foods that you see here. The dietary cholesterol is rarely a big problem. And what's interesting is that dietary cholesterol only comes from animal sources. So you could have an individual on a vegan diet, no animal products at all, no cholesterol at all, and they would still have high blood cholesterol. And that's in part because our bodies also make cholesterol. So there's, to some degree, we can affect the cholesterol in our blood with our diet, but we also have to keep in mind that there are certain people with certain genetic makeups that are just predisposed to having high blood cholesterol. I've met vegan diet adherents who are marathon runners who don't eat any saturated trans fat or cholesterol, and they still have sky-high blood cholesterol. But they're the exception, not the rule. Most people, your first line of defense if you have high cholesterol should be to trial cutting back on the saturated fat in your diet. We have a study here that was put together in conjunction with the National Institutes of Health and the AARP. And it was a diet and health study that looked at meat intake and mortality. And I mentioned meat because of the fact that it's the primary source of saturated fat in our diet. And what this study found, it looked at over 500,000 people. And the researchers determined that of those 500,000 people, the groups that ate the most amount of red meat, and that would be 5 ounces a day or more. And to put in perspective what 5 ounces looks like, we say that roughly the size of a deck of cards, or a computer mouse is a more modern analogy, is 3 ounces of meat. Okay, others say the size of the palm of your hand, but of course, our hands all differ in size, so that's not a great reference, but 3 ounces of meat is roughly a size of a deck of cards or a computer mouse. So slightly less than 2 decks of cards was 5 ounces of red meat, and that's a day. Those people were 30% more likely to die of heart disease or cancer over the next 10 years were those who ate the least amount of red meat, which was less than 2/3 of an ounce per day. Now, the high red meat intake eaters also more often than not tend to be the low fiber eaters, right? Because you're hard pressed to eat someone who sits down to a huge blood dripping steak and a big bowl of lentils along with it, okay? If you're gonna have the steak, you've got the baked potato, frankly not a whole lot of fiber, a lot of butter, a lot of sour cream, maybe some bacon, maybe some cheese. We know that the higher the meat intake an individual has, the lower their fiber intake tends to be. And last week when we spoke about fiber, we talked about the role that a high fiber fruit and vegetable diet has on protection against cancer. And researchers, they still go back and forth. Is there something protective in the fruits and vegetables that's preventing cancer? Or is there something harmful in the meat that's promoting cancer? Or is it, probably, some sort of combination of both? Now, we talked about lean meats, or I mentioned lean meats, red meats. This is the point of contention in the world of nutrition. These are the definitions that the USDA has set forth with regards to what's a lean meat. But this is different than what the food industry and what some other nutrition publications say. So the true USDA definition, and the USDA is tasked with oversight and safety of our meat supply, they say that a lean cut can have no more than 10% fat, okay? Extra lean cut steaks or roast can be by weight no more than 5% fat. Prime beef is the fattiest, select is the leanest, and choice is in the middle. And perhaps you know, if you work in the restaurant industry, that there's cuts of meat that restaurants can get that you can't in the grocery store. And that's because they're actually the highest level of fat, okay? So they have the most amount of marbling, and they're allowed to have the greatest percentage by weight of fat. On top of that, I've also heard at many of these steak houses, the reason why the steaks taste so particularly delicious is that in addition to the marbling, the chefs have a habit of taking butter in a toothpick and stabbing the butter into the middle of the steak before they grill it to make it even more tasty for you. So you're getting a combination of saturated fat from the meat and then saturated fat from the added butter. Now, when we look at our meats, we talk about portion sizes, and size does matter. People laugh at me as a dietitian when I say the size of a serving of meat should be the palm of your hand or a deck of cards. We know people don't eat like that. But when you hear a serving of red meat, if it's a government publication, they think you're eating 3 ounces of meat as a serving. Now think about your typical steakhouse. What's the smallest size steak you can usually order? How many ounces? 8 if it's a filet, or 6 if it's a petite filet. Okay, so let's say most people are going filet, okay? That's roughly, at 8 ounces, 3 servings of red meat. So when your doctor tells you, I don't want you to eat red meat more than twice a week, your doctor doesn't mean 2 times a week. Your doctor means 2 decks of cards worth of red meat. So that when you go and eat an 8-ounce filet and you're proud of yourself for not eating as much as your neighbor with the 16-ounce top sirloin over there, you've already surpassed the amount of red meat recommended if you're at risk for heart disease. Okay? Now, not all red meats are created equal, and I'll show you the difference in a second. But when we talk about meat, we can estimate that there's roughly a 25% shrink factor from raw to cooked. Okay? So if you buy a pound, 16 ounces of hamburger meat, and you form it into 4 4-ounce patties, when you cook that down, it'll be roughly 3 ounces of cooked. So when you look at recommendations and they say, eat a 3-ounce serving of meat, they mean 3 ounces cooked, which in turn is 4 ounces raw. I want to show you a little bit about the difference between meats and how easily we can be deceived if we're not paying attention to what's on our meat. Now, on the left-hand side, you see the nutrition facts panel for a serving size. This is 3 ounces, which is 85 grams, so 3 ounces cooked of a 70% lean ground beef patty. So you know when you go to the grocery store and you look at the beef, it says 70-30 or 80-20 or 90-10. The first number is lean and the second number is fat. And there's some very interesting studies that have come out recently showing that consumers think that because the lean is listed first, that no matter what it is, it's always healthy if it says the lean number first. Oh, it's 70% lean, that means that this is a lean meat. That's not what it means. It means 30% of that meat is fat. It's the highest fat that you can have is actually 75-25, but for most of us in the grocery store, we see 70-30. I'd like you to compare it to the right-hand side, which is a 95-5. So 3 ounces, if you were to make a hamburger that was 4 ounces raw and cooked down to 3 ounces cooked, 95% lean ground beef patty. Okay, so we're looking at 2 identical hamburgers with regards to portion size. But note how the fat and saturated fat numbers differ. Okay, 3 ounces of that patty on the right-hand side will give you 3 grams of saturated fat. And to put that in context, for almost everyone in this room, we need 20 grams of saturated fat or less per day. Okay? The food label is based on 20 grams a day. So if you look over here, this guy, the 75 or 70-30, one burger gives you twice as much saturated fat, which might not sound like a whole bunch, but if you ordered a hamburger at a restaurant and they served you a 3-ounce hamburger, that's a slider to us, right? That's 1/3 of an appetizer. Nobody eats a 3-ounce burger, okay? People eat 12-ounce burgers and 16-ounce burgers, at which point you've easily surpassed your saturated fat intake for the entire day. So if we look at a small portion size, yes, it's fine to have these meats in small portions. But the reality is, in our food environment, especially if we eat at restaurants, the serving size that you're going to be given is going to be 4 to 5 times that much. You blow your saturated fat budget with one food. Now, if the rest of your diet is made up of whole grains and fruits and vegetables, and on occasion you have a real good high-fat burger, that's fine. But remember that these are the meats that tend to be significantly cheaper in price than are the meats that you see on the right. And we know that these meats are what we're being served in the restaurants. They're higher in fat, higher in saturated fat, and of course they're cheaper for the restaurants to provide for us. Now the complaint is, that's a beautiful nutrition facts panel, but I don't like the way 95.5 ground beef tastes. It's dried out, it's chewy, etc. It does lack some of that fat. But for those of you that are experimental in the kitchen, if you experiment with different ways of cooking meat, namely roasting, and some of the more slow cookery methods, you can really make these lean meats taste very moist and taste very juicy. But they do have to be handled differently than the meats that we see that are significantly higher in fat. Question? Great question. Do we go by the grams or the percentage? With saturated fat on the food label, that right-hand column is percent daily value. For saturated fat, it's based on the number 20. So I'll show you an example in a second. If you eat a piece of cheese, there's 5 grams of saturated fat, that would be 25% of your daily value. I would encourage you to look more at the grams number and keep 20 in your head. If you sit down at Denny's to an eggs over my hammy for breakfast that has 20 grams of saturated fat in it at breakfast, that's it for the day. Okay, the rest of the day, no more meat, no more cheese, no more butter, no more oil, which you can do. But most people that start out their day eating 20 grams for breakfast are probably on a trajectory to eat 40, 60, 80 in a day. So you can look at either one, but it's based on 20 grams as the denominator in that percent daily value. Dry aged beef and the percent of the fat, I don't know about that. The new trend. Is it being marketed as being lower in fat? You hear a lot about grass-fed beef, much more grass-fed beef in the Bay Area than perhaps other parts of the country. Grass-fed beef is inherently lower in fat and saturated fat than is grain, which means corn-fed beef. The corn and grain-fed cows that make up the majority of the meat that people in this country eat are fed that product to make them fat very quickly so they can go to slaughter and turn a profit. Grass-fed cows, on average, have lower overall percent body fats, if you want to think of it that way. So when it turns into the meat that you eat, it's actually lower in fat and saturated fat. So in addition to the humanity and environmental aspects of eating grass-fed beef, it is nutritionally better for you because of a more favorable fat profile. But the dry age, I don't know about, so I'm sorry. They hang it to dry. I don't know how that affects the... But also, you see really silly things in meat manufacturing. Now, I noticed at Safeway the other day, 100% grain-fed beef. Wow, big deal. Corn is the grain that you're feeding it. But I think they think people, well, grass-fed, grain-fed, they're kind of close. Is that good? No, that's not what a cow was intended to eat. That's in no meat, by no means grass-fed. Question in the back? All right, I'm going to go ahead and look at poultry, because this is the next area where we get confused, okay? You're working your way away from red meat, trying to cut back on your saturated fat. Not all poultry is created equal. You hear this all the time from consumers. Oh, I'm doing such a good job with my diet, I'm just eating chicken. Oh, like, are you eating chicken breast or turkey breast? Oh, I hate that, it's dry, it doesn't taste good. What kind of chicken do you like? I love legs, wings, and thighs, okay? Ounce for ounce, legs, wings, and thighs, which are the dark meat of chicken, have just as much saturated fat as many cuts of red meat do. Not saying don't eat them, but don't fool yourself into thinking that you're eating a low-fat or low-saturated fat product. In order of fat per ounce, thighs are the fattiest, which is why they're the most delicious, wings, then drumsticks, then breasts, okay? A low-fat food and a low-fat meat like chicken breast or turkey breast and most types of fish, if it's low in fat, it's also gonna be low in saturated fat. The legs, the wings, the thighs, those are high in fat, and they're also very high in saturated fat. And don't fall for the turkey burger trick either, okay? Ground turkey is usually just ground up dark meat of turkey plus the skin, so it's actually worse for you than other types of red meat, okay? You can, of course, get extra lean, the lower fat ground turkey, okay, but just because something says turkey It's oftentimes calorie for calorie, fat gram for fat gram, and saturated fat gram for saturated fat gram exactly the same as a hamburger. Okay. As far as chicken goes, the very frustrating thing for us as consumers is that the meat lobby in this country is so powerful to the point where they've exempted themselves from food labeling laws. If you look at a steak in the grocery store and you turn it over, you don't get to see this type of information. But if you look at a can of soup, if you look at a frozen dinner, any other package, except with the exception of fruits and vegetables, which, you know, don't have as horrible nutrition profiles as many meats do, you get to see the label. There is legislation in the pipeline to change that, such that meat distributors and manufacturers would have to disclose what's in their meat. But right now, the general consumer, if they turn over a steak, they don't know that that 16-ounce steak has 200% of the saturated fat that they need for the whole day. And my guess is that as consumers become more interested in nutrition, increasingly, if that information were on the package, they would be less likely to buy it. But ignorance is bliss, right? That's why we eat at restaurants, and we know we can find the nutrition information, but people say, why would I want to ruin a perfectly enjoyable dining experience by knowing exactly what's in this, okay? With regards to your chicken, for some of your healthier products, when you see things like Laura's lean beef, or some of the Jennie-O, the leaner cuts of ground up chicken or poultry, they will voluntarily put their nutrition facts panels on there. But more often than not, especially with the dark meats, you never see that. So here on the left, we have 5 ounces of cut up chicken breast. And on the right, it's 5 ounces of cut up chicken thigh, just the meat only. Okay, and that's a cup, which is a cup of cut without bone or skin. You can see that 1 gram of saturated fat in the chicken breast compared to 4 grams of saturated fat. Again, that might not sound like much, but think about how big the average serving size of chicken is. We're breeding chickens to have larger breasts and larger and fattier components of meat so that we can meet the very large portion size desires of the way that we eat. You'll also note when there's less fat in a product, there's more protein in it. So if you had to say why it's even healthier, if you're interested in protein, it's that with less fat, and there's no carbs in meat, so we only get calories from the protein and the fat, you see with lower fat products like the chicken breast, the protein is 43 grams as compared to 36 grams. Now, to put this in context, most healthy adults in a day only need 50 grams of protein. Okay, that's a minimum. Now, if you exercise or you have a certain disease, you might need a little bit more. But look at 5 ounces of chicken breast. That's almost 100% of all the protein that you need in a day. So when we see people sitting down to 16-ounce chicken breasts at lunch and 12-ounce steaks at dinner, they're consuming way more protein than they need. The average American does eat more protein than he or she needs. And the majority of the types of protein that we eat are too high in saturated fat. Remember, that's the one that raises our bad cholesterol level. So if you couple that, the fact that we eat too much protein, and that it comes from high fat sources, remember that your body can store excess protein and excess fat as fat. So we have these people go to the gym, they get on the treadmill, they exercise, and they work off 200 calories. And they walk next door to Jamba Juice, they buy a 300 calorie protein shake, and they don't understand why they're not losing weight, okay? The excess calories from the protein, the sugar, that surpasses the calories that they burned, it's simply an equation in the sense that they're consuming excess calories, and your body can store any excess calorie, be it from fat, protein, carb, or alcohol, it can store it as fat. So watch your protein sizes and your portion sizes, not just for the saturated fat reasons, but also because most of us need a lot less protein than we're currently consuming. Question? How does bison compare to beef and chicken? Bison is traditionally a much leaner meat. It's lower in saturated fat and fat ounce per ounce. So is venison as well. So those are good sources of iron and protein with less fat. Question in the back? Are sandwich meats significantly different? As you mentioned, you know, most foods are not just one nutrient. The issue with sandwich meats tends to be that they're much higher in sodium than perhaps just plain chicken is. You know, chickens after you slaughter them don't have very much sodium in them. But even not sandwich meats, if you look at the chicken that you buy in the grocery store, if you look closely, many of those are injected with brine. It's to plump them up, and you buy your chicken based on weight, right? So it's basically paying a little bit more for a little bit less. You want to check the sodium on all of your meats. In the packaged pieces, you want to look for meat that says not packaged in brine. Now the smart ones are starting to say, listen, this is just chicken, no sodium. But your chicken or your meat should have very, very little sodium. So the lunch meats tend to be higher in sodium. My recommendation is, if you don't have a big problem with salt, is turkey, roast beef, and ham tend to be quite low in fat. You think, well, ham, that's a high fat food. Beef, that's a high fat food. They tend to be shaved so thin that ounce per ounce, you actually don't eat as much as if you were to sit down to a whole ham dinner or to a roast beef dinner. But you do want to watch out for the lunch meats that have, if you see any white specks of flat fat, things like, you know, bologna or pastrami or a lot of the cured Italian meats, those tend to be much higher in fat and saturated fat. So what happens when you cut out your saturated fat? We talked about the low-fat craze of the 1990s, where everyone's eating fat-free brownies and fat-free cookies. Well, we often see this clinically, that people who cut back on their saturated fat have another consequence, which is that their triglyceride levels raise. Your triglycerides are a type of fat that's also found in the blood, but they're very, very sensitive to sugar and alcohol. So if you cut out all the fat from meat, but replace all those and maybe more calories from Snackwell's fat-free cookies, your triglycerides will go up, okay? Because you're increasing the amount of sugar in your diet. Of course, that's not what we want. We don't want to reduce a bad fat and make sugar increase another type of fat in our blood. So the recommendation there is, if you're working to cut out your saturated fat, the way you can do that to lower your cholesterol but not increase your triglycerides is to focus on that magical nutrient from last week, which is fiber. The more fiber you have in your diet, as you cut back the saturated fat, it will help to keep your triglyceride levels in check. Okay, so fiber works to lower triglyceride levels in individuals that are working on swapping out their saturated fat. Okay, so when you cut out the fat in your diet, don't replace it with white breads or refined grains, but rather look to whole grains, fruits, vegetables, and legumes like the dried peas and beans and lentils. How much saturated fat do we need a day? We mentioned earlier, but the food label is based on 20 grams. And that's a nice round number to kind of keep in mind for yourself each day. Your saturated fat budget is 20 grams, but you can live with significantly less. Okay? The American Heart Association recommends no more than 7 to 10% of your calories. For most of us, that works out to 20 grams. Since grams are what we see on the food label, I would recommend you keep the number 20 in the back of your head and try to stay below that throughout the day. A good application of this is if we look at different types of milk. Okay, one of the reasons why, if you can tolerate dairy foods, you would drink milk is to get calcium and protein and vitamin A and vitamin D. But one of the problems with drinking a lot of whole milk is that, in addition to the calcium, vitamin A, vitamin D, and protein, you get a pretty hefty serving of saturated fat. One cup of whole milk, okay, the one that you tend to see in the red cartons, has 8 grams of fat, 5 of which are saturated. So think about that. More than half the fat in whole milk, which is an ostensibly healthy food, is coming from an unhealthy source, which is saturated fat. Now, if you switch that and you pick up skim or non-fat milk, okay, once you get over the initial shock, people say, I don't drink that stuff. It tastes like blue water. It's too thin. If you can't do non-fat milk, at least do 1% milk, okay? And look at what happens. You get the same amount of protein, you get the same amount, you actually get a little bit more calcium, same amount of vitamin D, and same amount of vitamin A. All the good stuff in milk you keep when you go to the non-fat or 1% versions, but note how the calories drop by almost half, the fat goes down to nothing, and as a result, the saturated fat goes down to nothing too. The Subway foot-long sandwich. How many pieces of cheese are on a foot-long sandwich? Full pieces. We'll see who the true Subway fans are here. Subway breaks the cheese in half, so it looks like 4, but it's just 2 full slices of cheese, right? A piece of cheese is just like a piece of whole milk, a cup of whole milk. It has 5 grams of saturated fat. So if you get a Subway foot-long, the cheese alone is giving you 10 grams of fat, saturated fat, excuse me. That's 50% of the saturated fat you should have in the day, right? You get 20 grams a day. At Subway, you just got 10 grams from your cheese. Now, this is the Italian BLT combo. It's always on the $5 foot long. I'm a big Subway fan. And I see a lot of people there. They order this sandwich. They go 10 grams of saturated fat on the cheese. There's 6 to 7 grams in those meats because they're choosing foods like pepperoni, salami, which are higher fat, higher saturated fat meats. And then if they put regular mayonnaise on it, they've gone pretty much over the 20 grams in lunch alone. Okay, now again, provided if there's no other saturated fat in the diet, that's okay. But the likelihood is that person is going over their saturated fat on a daily basis. If you like cheese, there's two things you can do if you're worried about saturated fat. Because there's two types of people. There's the person who says, I love cheese, I don't care what you do, I gotta eat cheese, but I like really, really good cheese. If you like really, really good cheese, just have smaller portions of it. Not to burst your bubble, but a portion of cheese is an ounce. We don't think in ounces, but think in household terms. An ounce is the size of a domino. Okay? If you're a cheese fan, that's not very much cheese. Okay? One domino has 5 grams of saturated fat. It's fine to eat one domino, but remember, you only get 4 domino-size worth pieces of cheese a day. So if cheese is gonna be your source of saturated fat, that's fine. But you're gonna have to watch your meat and your other high-fat dairy products. We have another side of people who say, I love cheese, I'll do anything, but I'm not gonna eat something as small as a piece of domino. I gotta have more cheese than that. My recommendation to those people is to go for reduced fat or low fat cheeses. I'm not saying, everyone rolls their eyes, but I'm not saying non-fat cheese, okay? Reduced fat cheeses have come a long way in the last couple of years. There's excellent sources of reduced fat or lower fat cheeses. And I would encourage you to do your own research at the places where you shop. Flip the cheese over and look at the nutrition facts panels. And you can find lower fat and saturated fat types of Jarlsberg, of Brie. Trader Joe's is an excellent place. They have a number of lower fat cheeses that taste really good. Again, they're not fat free, but if you want to keep larger, more reasonable portion sizes, you do have to make some concessions with regards to what type of fat is in there. I saw a couple of hands here when we were talking about milk and cheese. Okay, so how does coconut milk compare to whole milk? There's two types of coconut milk we can compare to. The type that you find in a can that we use traditionally in Asian cooking is mostly saturated fat. My recommendation is you usually use that sparingly. You don't, I hope not, drink cups of coconut milk. You might. But there's also now a shelf-stable or refrigerated type of coconut milk drink that's been thinned out with water, which actually has a lot less fat and saturated fat than traditional coconut milk. If you cook with coconut milk in Thai or Indian cooking, I personally never find a difference with using light coconut milk. It's nutritionally half the amount of saturated fat, and it really gives you that kind of pleasing mouthfeel. I think that's a good example of a good concession to make. You retain the flavor, but you're cutting out about half the saturated fat. Sheep or goat's milk cheese? I know that, I'm not sure about sheep's milk, but I do know that goat's milk cheese, ounce per ounce, does have less fat and saturated fat, but I don't know the exact information on that.
How about soy milk or almond milk?
How about soy milk or almond milk? So of course, many people can't tolerate dairy products, so this is all moot about the fat-free versus non-fat milk. If you're going for soy or almond milk, I would encourage you to always make sure that's a calcium-fortified beverage. There are still some out there that are not calcium-fortified. But rice milk, almond milk, soy milk, they tend to be lower in fat and saturated fat. However, many of them tend to be higher in sugar, okay? So vanilla soy milk is not the same as plain soy milk. People say all the time, I love plain soy milk. And that's not plain soy milk, that's vanilla soy milk, and it tastes so delicious because it has 3 to 4 teaspoons of sugar per cup. So make sure that you're not getting a sweetened version, okay? Great question. What if you can eat a lot of saturated fat and it doesn't result in weight gain? More importantly, some people can eat a lot of saturated fat and it doesn't affect their high cholesterol levels or their cholesterol. If you don't have high LDL levels and high cholesterol, if you have an active lifestyle, there's no rule that you have to stay at 20 grams of saturated fat a day. This is primarily for people who are at increased risk for heart disease, meaning someone in your immediate family has heart disease, or you yourself perhaps have high blood pressure, or high LDL levels. But we know, and I'll show you at the end here, that reducing the saturated fat in your diet, if you do, have those high levels is as effective, if not more effective, than certain types of statin drugs like Lipitor. So it's a very powerful way to use food before using medicine first in a population that's at risk. For the general population, if it's part of a well-balanced diet, you can certainly get away with higher fat diets. When we look at the Mediterranean diet, we'll see that that's a higher fat diet than we eat in the Western world, but it's not that high in saturated fat. It's high in the monounsaturated fats, and those are the ones that I'm gonna get to next. Trans fatty acids, we'll just spend a moment on it. Trans fats are not as prevalent in the diet as they were 10 years ago. In 2006, the government said, trans fats, we know, raise our LDL, just like saturated fats do. And so we should put them on the food label. Prior to 2006, they weren't on the food label, okay? Trans fatty acids, food manufacturers love them. They use a chemical process to hydrogenate the oil. It makes the fat more shelf stable. It's the reason why things like Twinkies and ding-dongs, they can stay on the shelf for years, right? Because they contain hydrogenated fats. And we said last week, if something has fat in it, it goes more rancid, more quickly than a fat-free product. But in addition to increasing the shelf life of these foods, it also has the effect of raising our bad cholesterol, lowering our good cholesterol, and overall increasing our risk of heart disease. So trans fats, which you see in the middle here, trans fatty acids have the hydrogens on opposite ends of the carbons on the fatty acid chain. But to put it in normal terms, it's foods that we eat that we shouldn't be eating a whole lot of. Trans fats tend to come in foods like pastries, cookies, donuts, pies, foods we know we shouldn't be eating that much of to begin with. One thing I do want to caution you on, though, is what's called the trans fat loophole. Okay, so starting January 1st, 2006, the government said, we know all this bad stuff about trans fats, we're gonna put it on your food labels. Well, manufacturers freaked out because their bad foods had a lot of trans fat in them. All of a sudden, American consumers are interested in trans fat. And prior to 2006, if you wanted to know if a food had trans fat in it, you had to look at the ingredient list and you had to find the word partially hydrogenated or partially hydrogenated oils. And in turn, you would have to know that that means trans fat and that's bad for me. Starting in 2006, they had to put trans fat right underneath total fat or saturated fat on the food label. But they also had this loophole that if a food contains 0.5 grams of trans fat or less, it can be called trans fat free. So let's say we have a cookie, a sandwich cookie, that has 0.49 grams of trans fat and you eat 10 of them, you just ate 5 grams of a trans fat free cookie. Okay. You still have to look in the label and search for hydrogenated oils. And I'll show you an example. We don't find a ton of trans fat in the diet because essentially what manufacturers did after 2006 was they said, oh, you're going to freak out about trans fats. They swapped the trans fats for saturated fats and started marketing trans fat-free foods that happen to have more saturated fat in them. Well, you guys know both saturated fats and trans fats raise our bad cholesterol. So you just swapped one bad thing for another bad thing. And yet, there's market data showing that people who see a food advertised as a trans fat-free food think it's healthy. But they don't notice that it has just as much saturated fat as it used to have trans fat in there. We'll show this difference with butter and margarine in a second. But not to pick on Post, but a good number of their kid-friendly cereals have trans fats in them. You see trans fat listed as 0 grams in this food, and yet you see in the food label partially hydrogenated oil. Okay, so take a look at your foods at home. You know, a little bit of trans fat is not going to kill you. Okay, but if this is what you're having for breakfast every day, and the oils in there are primarily trans fatty acids, you could be misled if you were just looking at the 0 grams. A little bit of research about trans fat. Perhaps you know that in New York, they banned trans fats. So New York City is really, as New York goes, then California goes, and eventually the rest of the nation. So they were the first ones to ban trans fat, and now researchers are looking to see, well, did that really do anything for our health? Generates a lot of interest, but if you just swap your trans fat out for saturated fat, what's the point if you're swapping one bad thing for another one? So this is a very small study, but in 2012, 168 randomly selected New York City locations of 11 fast food chains were surveyed. They interviewed customers before and then after the trans fat ban. And basically what they found out was that the trans fat intake decreased by about 2.5 grams, so from before to after the ban, but the saturated fat increased by about 0.5 gram. So it's not one for one. The foods were probably overall more healthy. The mean trans plus saturated fat reduction was by about 2 grams. And what the proponents of these different food bans, they really like to use this study and studies like this as an example to say the changes that we're enacting through these policies, such as banning this or banning that, are having an overall positive effect. Now, of course, we have no long-term data to see if this is actually played out to reduce mortality from heart disease, but it's a step in the right direction that it is reducing, to some degree, the amount of fat that people are eating, at least from fast food restaurants. So since we're here to talk about fat, we have to ask the age-old question, what's better for us, butter or margarine? Okay. People ask you that all the time as a dietitian. Is that, I don't get it. Is butter good for me? 1 week butter's good for me. 1 week margarine's good for me. I personally like to think about it as job security, because if the consumer is always confused about fats, there'll always be a job for me, hopefully, as a dietitian. But to clarify, no pun intended about the butter, but unsalted butter, okay, 1 tablespoon has 100 calories. Okay, a tablespoon is the big spoon on your kitchen spoons. 3 teaspoons is a tablespoon. 100 calories and 11 grams of fat in butter. Okay, 7 of those grams of fat are saturated. So 1 tablespoon has a little bit less than half of all the saturated fat you get in a day for your 20-gram budget. Margarine, on the other hand, also a tablespoon serving size, has 100 calories. It has 11 grams of total fat, 2 of which are saturated and 2 of which are trans. Okay, so you can, the margarine would be slightly healthier for you in the sense that it has less overall saturated fat, but then you have trans fat in a margarine product that you wouldn't have in the butter product. The answer to the question is butter better for you than margarine, or margarine better for you than butter? That neither is really good for you. Okay. Personally, if I'm going to eat a solid fat, I'm going to go for butter, and it's probably going to be salted butter, but in small portions, because if as a healthy adult I need roughly 2,000 calories, I don't want to waste 5, 10, 20% of those calories on butter. We know that the satiety effects of added fats, it's not the same as eating 100 calories of an apple when I eat 100 calories of butter. Again, when we eat in restaurants, we eat many, many more tablespoons or 100-calorie portions of butter or oil or margarine than you would if you cooked at home. Moving on to the unsaturated fats. Before we get there, does anyone have any questions about the trans fat or the saturated fat?
Actually, you hear a lot about ghee or clarified butter or butter oil, mm-hmm. and even so far as saying some sources say that they're good for you, but does that just mean they're not as bad for you?
So ghee is clarified butter, which has no effect on the saturated fat content. It's just had the impurities removed from it. So it might be marketed as more pure, but it's certainly not a healthier fat for you. And I'll just bring up coconut oil, because I'm sure everyone has questions about that. People asking a lot about coconut oils and is coconut oil and coconut butter and cocoa butter healthier for me? Coconut oil, we know the coconut products, the fat, is almost all saturated fat. While there's a little bit of emerging data showing that it might not be as harmful as the saturated fats that we get from animal products, the general rule of thumb from most public health bodies is that coconut-based fats are just saturated fats, and they raise your LDL as readily as other animal-based saturated fats do. That they really don't, they shouldn't play a large role in your diet, despite a lot of conflicting marketing around these coconut-based products.
Could I throw mayonnaise in?
Sure.
I'm curious about how bad that is.
So mayonnaise is, what are the main ingredients in mayonnaise? Eggs and oil. And so it depends what type of oil you have. I tend to go for, if you don't make your own mayonnaise at home, the olive oil based mayonnaises have a little bit better of a nutrition profile. I think they taste pretty good. They're still high in fat if you buy the full fat versions, but if you use them sparingly and if you go for the olive over some of the vegetable oil ones, they're better bets. And I'll show you what vegetable oil is in a second, and you'll see it's really not that great for you.
Can I ask you a quick question? Because
sure.
I noticed this on nutrition labels a lot. On your prior slide, it said total fat 11 grams, saturated 2, and trans fat 2. Where are the other 7?
Great question. Where are the other 7 grams of fat? 11 minus 2 minus 2? Those are unsaturated fatty acids, mono and polyunsaturated fats, which is what we're going to go to next. Sometimes the law says you do not have to post your unsaturated fatty acid content, but some products do want to post it. So if you look at, for example, oatmeal, if they have a little bit of fat, they want to show you that it's a healthy fat. So you can voluntarily insert poly and monounsaturated underneath there if you want to, but you don't have to. Great question.
What happens when you heat fat, and what fats are best?
So what happens when you heat fat? So if you cook, perhaps you know about the different smoke points of oil. For example, peanut has a significantly higher smoke point. So from a culinary standpoint, it might make a difference as far as what foods taste good, et cetera. From a nutritional standpoint, it doesn't change the fatty acid profile. However, there's some data showing that very, very high heat, especially if we're cooking meat fats at very, very high heats plus the protein, it could potentially be carcinogenic, but there's no real change in nutrition profile just when you cook it. It just tends to get liquid and we can eat a lot more of it when it's heated up. Any questions from this side? Alrighty, so let's get into our good fats now. We're gonna look at the monounsaturated and the polyunsaturated ones, okay? Remember, the saturated fats are the ones that have no room for any more hydrogens on the carbon chain. The mono meaning one, means that you see, as you see in the top figure here, one carbon-carbon double bond. Essentially, there's one point of unsaturation. A polyunsaturated fat, which you see in the second and third images here, they have two or more points of unsaturation, okay? So these are the ones that are gonna start being kind of kinked in shape, and they're not gonna stack as nicely as those saturated ones. As a result, these unsaturated fatty acids tend to be liquid at room temperature as opposed to solid. Now, if you've heard of omega-3 and omega-6, if you're ever curious how they get those names, if the first double bond occurs between the sixth and the seventh carbon atom from the omega end, and this is the omega end and this is the acid end on the right. So omega end on the left and acid end on the right. If you count, for example, in the middle one, counting left to right, if once you get to carbon number 6, if the first double bond is between carbon number 6 and carbon number 7, that's an omega 6 fatty acid. And I'll talk in a second what the difference between omega 6s and 3s are. But at the bottom, this is an omega 3 fatty acid. The first carbon-carbon double bond occurs after the third carbon going from the omega to the acid end. Okay, so we've got omega-3 fatty acid, omega-6 fatty acids. They're both examples of polyunsaturated fatty acids. The monounsaturated fatty acid is the one that you see at the top, and that's what we're gonna start with. Both types of unsaturated fatty acids, poly and mono, they tend to be healthier for us than are the saturated and the trans ones. I'll show you a resource at the end, but the American Heart Association has put together a cute little kind of cartoon way to teach not just kids, but all consumers about the differences between goods and bad fats. And they have the bad fat brothers, trans and sat, and the good fat sisters, mono and poly. Okay, so these are the good guys if you're thinking about it from a heart healthy standpoint. Okay, and when you hear about good fats, okay, avocado, canola, olive, peanut, olives, peanut butter, sesame seed, nuts. And if you look at those foods grouped together, perhaps you automatically start to think of the Mediterranean diet. And we'll talk a little bit about that towards the end, but the Mediterranean diet is a high-fat diet. It's more than 30% of calories from fat. But the types of fat that they're made up of are the types that we almost call the heart-healthy fats. Now, I'm a little hesitant to use the term heart-healthy fats very regularly because too much of a good thing is still not a good thing, okay? We have people who make a beautiful stir fry and then they pour canola oil all over it. You got a cup of oil, okay, which is a significant amount of calories. And there's too many calories, even if it's from a good fat. Remember, your body can store that as fat. So all good things in moderation. We want to choose these types of fats over the saturated and trans fats, but it's not a free food. You can't go crazy with your olive oil. With regards to cooking, if you do use oils and you're trying to watch your calories and your fat, it's recommended that you spray your oil and not pour it. Okay, you can buy, for example, the Misto olive oil sprayer. It's $5 or $6 online. You pour your oil in there, hopefully olive oil or canola oil, and then you pump it and you spray it which gives you the flavor of the fat, gives you that non-stick approach, if that's why you're using it, if you're doing it in a frying pan, but you're not getting the hundreds of calories that you would get when you pour the fat on. So I mentioned some of these different types of oils. And people say, well, I use vegetable oil. Is vegetable oil good for me? And vegetable oil is kind of a touchy subject, because vegetable oil, all it means is that it is a reflection of a whole bunch of different types of oils. Whatever was the cheapest on the market that day, they poured them all together in a bottle and called it vegetable oil. Vegetable oil can be made up of any type of these different types of oils that you see here. And what the colors represent is the red, that's the bad fat, the saturated fat. The more the percentage of fatty acids are comprised of the saturated fat, the less healthy we say it is. So we see things like coconut oil, butter, palm oil, lard. Those are all more or close to 50% of the fat in there comes from saturated fatty acids. Okay? If vegetable oil is made up of some of those different types of oil, it could have very high amounts of saturated fat. On the flip side, the yellow implies what percent of the fatty acids are coming from monounsaturated fatty acids. Okay, the good ones. Now the polys are good too, but we'll just focus on monounsaturated fats. And you hear sometimes health professionals say, if you use oil at home, it should be olive oil or canola oil. Okay, and that's my recommendation. There's really no need for vegetable oil in the house. Anything vegetable oil can do, canola oil can do better. Okay, it costs the same, it tastes the same, it behaves the same in any of the cooking or baking that you're doing, and yet the canola oil you can see here at the top is almost 60% of the monounsaturated fats and only a very, very small amount of the saturated fat. Now here's the comparison of vegetable oil nutrition profile and canola oil nutrition profile. Remember, they look the same, they're right next to each other in the oil aisle, they cost the same, they act the same. If you look at the saturated fat, you get 10 grams in a tablespoon of vegetable oil, but you get only 1 gram of saturated fat in a tablespoon of canola oil. There's really no reason not to be buying canola oil and buying vegetable oil, as you can see from the saturated fatty acid comparison there. Olive oil looks almost identical to that. You could almost swap out the name there. Olive oil is almost all poly or monounsaturated fatty acids and very, very little saturated. So you really want to aim for olive oil and canola oil in your house and really try to stay away from the vegetables or anything that has a high amount of saturated fat like you see there. Question? Where does canola oil come from? It comes from rapeseed. Beyond that, I am not a canola expert. So does anyone have input about canola oil?
I don't know.
Oh.
I have another question.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry, I don't know much about canola oil.
Is it the lack of the hydrogens that
What is it about the molecular structure of the saturated fatty acids? I am by no means a molecular fat expert, and as far as the actual metabolism or how it behaves in the body, I certainly couldn't explain. But I do know that we do have really good data showing us that the higher the saturated fat content of the foods we eat, the higher the levels of our LDL cholesterol is. And that's the primary outcome that we're looking at, with the exception now of all this data we have about the Mediterranean diet. We know it's not just your cholesterol levels, that the more of those healthier fats you use, the lower the likelihood of having heart disease and heart attack and death from heart disease, which are really, really important endpoints. Because I know for many people in this room, you probably don't have high cholesterol yet. Okay? The older you get, all of our cholesterol is going up. But it's good to know that eating this way can help us reduce death from all types of cardiovascular events. And you want to keep in mind that many people who have heart attacks actually have normal lipid profiles. Okay? They might eat a horrible diet, take Lipitor, get their LDL down, and think they're out of the woods. Okay? But we know that it's so much more, and that these good fats are possibly protective, not to mention the fiber and all the other nutrients that we get in there. A little bit more about diet comparison. So how does this play out in the foods that we eat? It's very hard to study the long-term effects of fad diets or diets that you've heard of, primarily because most people don't stay on them, right? They do it for a high school reunion, or they do it to get ready for a certain event, and then they go back to eating the way that they want to. So many of the studies that you see about looking at fad or popular diets don't discount them just because the sample size is small, because we don't have any really that have large sample sizes. And the perfect example of this is with the Atkins diet, right? The low carb, high protein diet. Proponents of the Atkins diet say, show me the data that says that this is a harmful diet for me to be on long term. And people who are opposed to the diet say, show me a population of people who actually stay on this diet for longer than 2 weeks, and I would be happy to study them. We just don't have the long-term data that we need to really see the effects of these. So having said that, we have a small study here published in 2009 that looked at 18 different subjects. And they were on a 4-week maintenance phase of 3 different diets. We mentioned last week that it's much easier to do really, really big nutrition studies if you ask people what they ate, okay, than opposed to if you control the amount of food that they eat for a very long time. That's very, very expensive and very hard to do. But of course, we have the inherent limitations of reported data. I mean, I can't remember what I ate this morning, let alone what I ate from the beginning of my lifespan if I'm answering a food questionnaire for your cancer and diet study. In this study, though, the researchers did control the food that the people ate. There's 3 different diets that they study. Okay, the South Beach diet, which is kind of a Mediterranean approach. It's lower in carbohydrate than a traditional diet and high in protein. The Ornish diet, okay, perhaps you know Dr. Dean Ornish, who's on the faculty here at UCSF, and a very large proponent of an ultra-low-fat diet. He's done a lot of research about the effects of low-fat diets, particularly on prostate cancer. Okay, so very, very low-fat, less than 10% of the calories from fat. And then looking at the Atkins diet, the high-fat, high-protein, low-carb diet. And the researchers were looking at the effect on the LDL, okay, and the LDL being the bad cholesterol levels. Okay. What they found was that in doing brachial artery testing to measure the flow-mediated vasodilation, okay, they basically were looking at what does this do with regards to your heart disease risk profile, they found that the lower fat diets, South Beach and Ornish, lowered your LDL cholesterol, whereas the Atkins diet increased your bad cholesterol. And when we look at people who go on the Atkins diet, we definitely do not recommend it for people who are at risk for heart disease. Because even if you lose weight and we see your bad cholesterol going up, that's a negative outcome that we don't want. And with dietary changes, it's important to point out that if you adopt a lower saturated fat and higher fiber diet, even if you don't lose weight, you can actually see improvements in your LDL. Because some people say, I'm not overweight, I just have high cholesterol. And when you look at what they're eating and look at the sources of fat, if you manipulate it, it might not have any effect on their weight, but we can see changes in their LDL, and that's the outcome that we want.
Why did you say a few minutes ago that typically your cholesterol might not be an issue when you're younger, but as you get older, everybody's rises?
Why does our cholesterol rise? Are there any cardiologists in the room who want to answer it? My understanding is that from the time you're a baby, you're starting to lay down plaque in your arteries. And that there's a way that the atherogenic diet, the one that makes us have more plaque and higher rates of heart disease, come from these saturated fats. The older we get, whether we like it or not, our blood pressure is gonna go up, our pancreas becomes less efficient and puts out less insulin. Everything works a little bit less efficiently. One of the things that tends to expedite it, though, and is interesting, is the effect of exercise. That the older we get, we tend to exercise and be less active, and yet regular exercise and regular physical activity does have a protective effect in that it can help to lower LDL cholesterols. So some of it's not just diet, it's also lowered activity levels as we get older. So I want to mention cholesterol because we're talking about blood cholesterol, but what's the relationship between dietary cholesterol? Okay. Dietary cholesterol, again, is essential for human health. We need it to live. Okay. It's found in our diet, but our body also makes it. Okay. So you hear those drug commercials. Our drug treats the 2 sources of cholesterol. Okay. You know, well, one's your diet and the other one's your family. Now, you can make changes in your diet to lower your blood cholesterol. But remember, it's not the cholesterol in your foods that really play that big of a role on your blood cholesterol. It's the saturated fat in your diet, okay? All cholesterol comes from animal-only foods, okay? So we should not be impressed when we go to a restaurant and see a sign that says, our French fries are fried in cholesterol-free peanut oil, okay? A peanut never had a liver. A peanut was never an animal product. A peanut never had cholesterol in it to begin with, okay? Peanuts, even Planters peanuts, as a cholesterol-free food. There's nothing special about Planters peanuts. All peanuts are cholesterol-free foods, okay? So we want to lower the amount of cholesterol in our diet. Some people are very, very sensitive to dietary cholesterol. They eat more cholesterol and their blood cholesterol goes up, but that's very, very rare. What we do have to keep in mind, especially with high cholesterol foods like shellfish, is when we have a nice, delicious crab or lobster dinner, what do we usually dip that in?
Butter.
Okay? A lot of the seafoods that we eat that are high in cholesterol, we traditionally tend to pair with other high saturated fat foods. For example, butter, and gave the example of eating that nice fish meal. I mean, most white fish doesn't have a lot of cholesterol in it, but we do have to be careful about the additives that we're adding on. When people hear about cholesterol, they automatically think eggs. Okay, what's the deal with eggs? Are they good or bad? Again, job security, some weeks eggs are good for us, another week a study comes out and says eggs are bad for us. But how much cholesterol should we be eating? Okay. There's an approach called the therapeutic lifestyle choice, TLC diet. And I'll show you at the end kind of the overview of the TLC diet. But it basically says if you're at risk for heart disease, okay, meaning someone in your family has heart disease, or your doctor said, listen, you have high cholesterol, or you have high blood pressure, someone, especially if someone young in your immediate family, under 60, has had a heart attack, that puts you at big risk for heart disease. And you should be limiting, in addition to your saturated fat, your cholesterol. The recommendation is 200 milligrams of cholesterol a day, okay? And an egg has 186 milligrams of cholesterol. So on average, if you have a concern about cholesterol and you're trying to limit your dietary cholesterol 200 milligrams a day, you can essentially eat upwards of 7 eggs a week. But when you work with patients who are eating 3 and 4 eggs sometimes, you know, if you go out to breakfast and you have scrambled eggs, it's not just 1 or 2, it's usually 3 or 4, or if you have an omelet, if you're doing that more often than not and surpassing the 7 eggs per week recommendation, for people at high risk for heart disease, we recommend against that. The cholesterol is found primarily in the yolk, but that's also where some other important nutrients are found as well. Okay? The reality is, though, we tend not to be deficient in the things that we find in egg yolks, so there's really no harm in taking the yolks out and discarding them if you're concerned about your cholesterol. If you like eggs, focus more on the whites. For every egg yolk you use 2 or 3 egg whites. To get more protein, to perhaps feel more full, because remember, protein helps us feel full, but to keep the fat and the cholesterol down. We also have to think about what we're cooking our eggs in, right? If we're frying them in bacon grease, who cares if we took all the fat of the yolk out, if we've got the saturated fat from the grease there. So any questions about cholesterol? It's kind of something we almost pass over a little bit, because the focus when we're working on our blood lipids is really to look at the saturated fat.
Question about this slide.
Sure. What if one day you eat 7 eggs? Perfect question. It's like the alcohol recommendations. Yeah. If I can have one glass of wine a day, can I just save all 7 till Saturday? It depends what else you're doing with your diet. But again, unless you're in an unusual situation where you're particularly sensitive to dietary cholesterol, it's perfectly fine to save them for the weekend. And that's actually a good recommendation, is save your eggs for the weekend, especially if you have a more leisurely, perhaps more involved breakfast on the weekend. And on the weekdays, maybe you have something more like oatmeal or that you know is a better, heart healthier choice. Question in the back? So if you eat 1 egg in the morning and then a hamburger at night, you're well over your cholesterol. There's actually not a ton of, it depends what type of cut of hamburger or whatever the lean and fat is. It tends not to be super high, but again, if you're having a large portion, you know, a 12 or 16 ounce steak, yes, you would easily be over that. But then if the next day you go absolutely no cholesterol, it's all a balance. It doesn't really matter day by day. All of this stuff is aggregated, right, over weeks and months and years of how we eat. So I want to move on to the omega-3 fatty acids. These are a group of polyunsaturated fatty acids, and they're what we call essential fatty acids. In nutrition, if something is essential, it means you can't make it in your body. You have to eat it from your diet. So examples like vitamin C, we don't make that. We have to get it somewhere from our diet. But another example is vitamin D. We actually can make that from the sunlight. So it helps when we get some from our diet, but it's not truly essential. Omega-3 fatty acids are important from a health standpoint in that they help to mediate inflammation. So when we hear about this anti-inflammatory diet, you almost always see fish on it, okay? And an anti-inflammatory diet is one that tends to be high in fruits and vegetables and low in fat and saturated fat. Omega-3 fatty acids are of interest to researchers because they also may be helpful in relieving symptoms that are related to arthritis and age-related macular degeneration. Now, there's different types of omega-3 fatty acids, and the one I want to focus on today is the combination of what's called EPA plus DHA. I'll show you an example of ALA in a second. Now, when I say omega-3 fatty acids, you probably think of fish, okay? And fish really is the best source of EPA plus DHA, okay? This is the combination, especially it's so important in infants because it helps to promote brain development, okay? So breast milk is a very rich source of EPA plus DHA. And that's good for kids and infants in helping their brain development. Formulas are also fortified with EPA and DHA so that they try to get the same nutritional benefits. But we as adults, we get the majority of our EPA and DHA from fatty fish. Okay, and the fatty fish tend to be things like salmon, herring, mackerel, trout, and sardines. But you also hear, well, I've heard that things like flax and canola are good sources of omega-3s. I don't like fish, so can I just eat a whole bunch of flaxseed and get my omega-3s? The type of omega-3 fatty acid that we get in those non-fish sources can be converted, but albeit in very, very small amounts, to EPA plus DHA in the body. We don't know a ton about the health effects of ALA, the type that you find in the non-fish sources, but we do know about EPA and DHA, and that's why I want to focus on those recommendations today. This is what the American Heart Association tells us. If you like fish, I'll show you in the next slide, the content of EPA plus DHA in the different fish that you eat. But many people don't like fish, or they don't eat the recommended serving of fish per week. So what the American Heart Association says is if you don't have any documented coronary heart disease, you should just be aiming to eat fish at least 2 times per week. And that's 2 servings of fish. So 2 3-ounce, remember, deck of cards sizes. So it's really just 1 normal 6-ounce piece of fish. Because you really have to eat a big piece of fish 1 time a week. Okay, so 3 3.5-ounce cooked. So fish probably down from 5 ounces to 3.5. Okay, 3/4 cup flaked fish. Now, that's for people that aren't at risk for heart disease. But the recommendations change quite dramatically if you do have documented heart disease. In that case, the recommendation is 1 gram. Okay, that's 1,000 milligrams. So on the next slide, when we see the different types of fish, keep in mind this number 1 gram, 1,000 milligrams, preferably from fatty fish, but we also have to acknowledge that maybe we're not gonna get that much fish, and in that case, fish oil supplements are going to become important. Fish oil supplements are also helpful for people who have very high triglyceride levels, okay? They sometimes take pills in the range of 2 to 4 grams a day. Most fish oil as a supplement is available over the counter, but there's also one brand of prescription fish oil that sometimes the cardiologist will prescribe for people that have very, very high triglycerides. So if we look at the fish, we look at Atlantic salmon farmed. Okay, now these are 6-ounce servings. Okay, and again, the servings in every body kind of differ, so I apologize that they're not consistent, but 6 ounces, again, about 2 decks of cards. Atlantic salmon, 3,650 milligrams of fish, okay, of EPA plus DHA. Now, if you're that person that needs 1,000 a day, you roughly have to eat 2 servings of that fish a week, right? 3,500 plus 3,500 is gonna give you 7,000 milligrams in a week. And you need about 1,000 a day. That's if you're at the highest risk, okay? And then it goes down from there. You hear increasingly about the benefits. You know, we think that having wild salmon for ecological and environmental reasons would be better, but now you hear farmed salmon proponents saying farmed products are better for you. And when they say that, what they mean is that they have slightly higher levels of EPA plus DHA, because in the farmed fish setting, we can control the feed that the fish eat, and it tends to be laden or supplemented or fortified with EPA plus DHA. So a slight benefit to farmed fish is that it might have more EPA plus DHA. But what about people who don't eat those levels of fish? What about fish oil pills? Okay. A study done in 2012, a double-blind, 2x2 factorial design, looked at about 12,500 people who were at high risk for heart disease, or they had diabetes or prediabetes. And they were randomized to a group that got either 1 gram of fish oil, okay, or a placebo, and then some other different procedures or therapies for their diabetes. Okay? And this is 2 slides, so I'll show you the results on the next slide. But what the researchers were looking at was, does this help prevent or lower death from heart disease after 6-year follow-up? And what the researchers found was that 9.1% who were in the omega-3 group and 9.3% who were in the placebo group died from cardiovascular diseases. Essentially, that there was virtually no difference between the intervention and the controls for these different endpoints related to heart disease. Okay, now, omega-3 fatty acids do help lower triglycerides. So if your doctor says to you, you do have high triglycerides and you don't eat a lot of fish, you certainly would want to consider fish oil capsules. A couple words about fish oil capsules. If you do need that 1,000 milligrams a day, pay special attention to the labeling on the supplements. Just like food serving sizes, supplements get to pick their portion sizes. So sometimes a serving is 3 capsules a day in order to get that 1,000 milligrams of EPA plus DHA. And the general recommendation is, if you're not going to take the full dose, don't even waste your time. Don't take 1 pill, don't take 2 pills. If you need the full 1,000, you've got to take those 3 pills a day. If you find that fish oil bothers you, or when you're burping you kind of get that fishy taste, one thing you can do is to freeze your fish oil capsules. That tends to cut back on the fishiness. We have some new data showing us that fish oil can also help prevent to some degree against dementia. Okay, so supplementation among cognitively healthy older people may be helpful to help reduce dementia. And fish oil is one of those supplements that there's really no harm in taking it. If you can afford it, and provided it's not displacing other healthy foods in your diet, if you don't eat a ton of fish, you might as well consider taking an omega-3 supplement. And I would say after multivitamins, that's probably the supplement that you see, along with calcium and vitamin D, recommended the most by doctors. Okay. Now we hear about omega-6s too. What about those? And I'll tell you, in the interest of time, most people get plenty of omega-6 fatty acids. They're found in all sorts of plant oils that we all eat plenty of. The recommendation that most dietitians and health bodies recommend is you want to increase the amount of omega-3s in relation to the 6s. You basically want to eat less added plant oils if you can, and replace those with more fish oils if you do consume those foods. There's some trickery out there, though. And I want to just show you a product that is an example of many other different types of products on the market. This is a Smart Balance, and all over its packaging and its website, it says an excellent source of omega-3. Well, that's great. I don't like fish. I love butter. I'm just going to eat this butter instead of the fish to get my omega-3s. But I want to point out that it's not the same type of omega-3 fatty acid, that EPA plus DHA, that we know has the anti-inflammatory effect. And to be honest, if you were even moderately at high risk for heart disease, you don't need the 1,000 grams. The American Heart Association says you need 500 grams a day. If you were to use this product, you would have to eat 16 tablespoons of it. So basically, you would have to eat roughly 1,250 calories worth of a butter spread to get the amount of EPA plus DHA that you would get in 6 ounces of fish, okay? This is not an excellent source of omega-3s, not to mention that it just contains the ALA, not the EPA plus DHA. It has a tiny bit of EPA plus DHA. A tablespoon has 32 milligrams. Most of you need 500, and some of you need 1,000 in a day. But yet, people are paying money for products like this, for higher omega-3 eggs and different sorts of salad dressings, and they're confused because it says omega-3. Keep in mind, it's not the same. Don't waste your money on these products. If you need to buy an enhanced product, buy a fish oil supplement.
I don't know where it would be available in amounts large enough to meet the recommendation, but how does synthesized EPA DHA compare to fish oil?
So how does synthesized EPA plus DHA compare? And I think the question's asked in relevance to contamination. A couple of years ago, there was a big internet rumor that if fish is contaminated with mercury, which it can be, Okay. Now, fish from the, we know, especially if you catch fish in the San Francisco Bay Area, it's really advisable not to eat it, but most of us aren't catching the fish that we're eating. Consumer Reports did a really nice large-scale study looking at almost every single mainstream brand of fish oil, and what they found out is there's absolutely no reason for you to be concerned about contamination of mercury in fish oil supplements. There hasn't been a documented case of it or in any large number. The benefits of taking that fish oil far outweigh any concerns about contamination. And when that study came out, it really kind of just tamped down that rumor. So really, there's no concern for contamination of mercury if you are taking fish oil supplements. How a synthetic brand would compare to a natural one, I really don't know. I know sometimes vegans ask questions, and there's certain vegan preparations that you can get. As far as, you know, there's so many other things at play with regards to how we absorb nutrients that I think it's quite hard to say.
What about farmed versus wild fish? Is there...
So what about farmed versus wild fish? On average, farmed fish does tend to have more omega-3s, but many would argue that that's a very small benefit for what would be other environmental detriments. Oh, what about mercury? Actually, the mercury that tends to, mercury levels on the whole tend to be lower in farmed sources because the feed is very controlled. The general rule of thumb is if you are pregnant or if you are breastfeeding, you need to be concerned about your fish intake and you should have no more than 12 ounces a day. Across the board, almost every other body says the benefits of eating more fish far outweigh any potential detriments for concerns about mercury. The bigger the fish you eat, the more mercury there is, right? It's higher up on the food chain. It ate all the smaller fish and all of their bioaccumulated mercury. But the reality is most of us aren't eating those super huge fish. And if you're not pregnant and not breastfeeding, it's really not a concern, with the exception of certain geographical areas. And you can look on the EPA, Environmental Protection Association's website, and there you can find which spots are higher concentrated areas of mercury, and the Bay Area is like a big red concentrated area. But again, we don't have country of origin labeling laws on fish in this country. Most of the fish that you eat, you have absolutely no idea where in the world it came from.
You don't mention canned tuna.
Okay, so you meant to canned tuna. Albacore tuna, the white one, is actually slightly higher in mercury than is the cheaper pink one. So if you need a reason to cheap out at the grocery store on your tuna, the pink is a little bit lower in mercury. For pregnant and breastfeeding women, they can't have more than 12 ounces a week, and no more than 6 should come from canned tuna. A tin of tuna is 6 ounces. So if you're one of those groups, keep your tuna to 1 tin or less per week. Is canned tuna a pretty good source of omega-3? Some of them market it as that. No one's required to put that on the food label. It's very, the FTC has gotten involved, I believe, in some cases saying, you know, excellent source of omega-3, but if you're not saying exactly how much is in it and you're not paying to do that testing, they really shouldn't be putting that. It is a better source than some of the lower fat fish, but exactly how much, it's very variable. The fatty fish, are they high in cholesterol? They tend to be higher in cholesterol, yes, but not as high as shellfish.
Oh, yes. You know, same with recently brought to market milk with DHA omega-3 and with no calories.
Oh, she brought the.
It just came to the market.
So this is a milk product. A Horizon Park DHA omega-3 supports brain health. One cup of this has 32 milligrams. Remember, you need 500 in a day. So how many cups of this milk would you have to eat or drink? Hundreds or thousands of calories worth. This is inconsequential, and yet, remember, the front of the package is the commercial, right? The side is really where the information is. In this case, it happens to be in small print, but this does have added DHA, but it's inconsequential, so. I do want to finish up just by mentioning the Mediterranean diet, and one of our most favorite people in the study of nutrition and nutrition history is Dr. Ansel Keys. Perhaps you're familiar with his work. He's the K in the K ration, okay? So if you were a military, you might not like him as much as dietitians do, but he's also what we call the father of the Mediterranean diet, which, of course, the Mediterranean diet was around long before Dr. Keyes. He lived for 100 years, though, so many would say it's a kind of a testament to the way that he ate. But he was very integral in a study that he published called The Biology of Human Starvation. And following World War II, there was this opportunity to liberate all of these very, very malnourished and starved people from the concentration camps. And yet, in the field of nutrition science, we knew nothing about how to nutritionally rehabilitate these groups. And so Dr. Ansel Keys did really the groundbreaking work on how do you rehabilitate a habitually starved person. You can't just go back to eating the way you used to eat prior to starvation. There's a very, very set up way to feed and reintroduce nutrients. And he was the leader in that field, the developer of the K ration, and also the father of what we call the Mediterranean diet. And he published what was called the 7-country study. And from a period of 1958 to 1970, he looked at men in 18 different areas of 7 different countries, hence the name the 7-country study. And he was fascinated with heart attacks in American men. He was from Minnesota. He saw a lot of sedentary Caucasian men as they get older dying from diseases that people in other countries didn't. He had noticed that throughout his studies and his other work. So he wanted to understand why certain groups in other countries didn't die from heart disease despite the fact that they were getting older, they might have been sedentary. And what he basically broke it down to was, he said, if some developed countries can do without heart attacks, why can't we? And he was interested in other developed countries. And this is, he started to concentrate his work and really look at the area of the Mediterranean area. And to look at their diet, because they used to think, well, it's a high fat diet that increases risk of heart disease. But he would look at these groups in Italy and Greece and some of the other Mediterranean regions and see really low rates of heart attack and wondered why. So he demonstrated that your heart disease risk can be manipulated with diet. And the focus really was on what were called the good fats. Okay? So he did, this is kind of just a summary, he did a chemical analysis of all the foods that they ate and a diet recall. The Mediterranean diet that Dr. Keys, he's the one to first coin the term Mediterranean diet, encompasses all of the things that you've probably heard of and we've touched on a little bit throughout this lecture. And I wanted to end it on a high note with the focus on fat should be a very important part of our diet, and yet it's the source of fat that we really want to focus on. And the Mediterranean diet, if you had to pick a way to eat, we're increasingly seeing research show us that this is the way that we should be eating. You shouldn't adopt a low-fat diet that's full of sugar or a really, really high-fat meat diet that doesn't have enough carbohydrate and is all saturated fat. If you're going to have fat in your diet, which you should, it should be from most of these heart-healthy fats. So the principles of the Mediterranean diet are that primarily it's plant-based. There might be meat in there, but it's in much small portions and much less frequent than we have in our diets. Low in processed food, emphasize on fresh food, includes foods from the sea. The notion being, for every fish meal you're eating, that's one less red meat meal, hopefully, that you're eating. There's dairy in moderation and wine in moderation. And there's mention of activity as part of a healthy lifestyle with a focus on good fats and primarily olive oil. So the Old Ways group, if you check out oldways.org, they have a whole host of different models of eating, how people eat around the world. And they put together what's called the Mediterranean diet pyramid. And if you'll notice, some of the foods that tend to be really prevalent in the Western lifestyle are actually centered higher on this pyramid. Foods like poultry, eggs, cheese, and yogurt. They put meats at the top of their pyramid. If you remember our old 1992 food guide pyramid, meat was somewhere around the middle, even closer to the bottom for us. The Mediterranean flips that on its head and says the meats and the dairy and the animal products should be just a small part of what you eat. They also add activity. We tend to focus so much and we spend billions of dollars on diet products in this country, totally ignoring the other side of the equation, which is if you don't exercise or you're not physically active, all of the dietary manipulation in the world does you no good. The Mediterranean diet also adds something that our Western food guides have not included, and that's mention of alcohol. That alcohol in moderation, and again, moderation is considered to be one drink per day for women and no more than 2 drinks per day for men, but especially red wine. That tends to have higher antioxidant capacity, potentially could have some longevity issues. It's beneficial with regards to your diet, provided that it's done in moderation. Okay? In the Mediterranean diet, it's pretty high in calories from fat, 35% in some cases. But you'll note that the saturated fat is low. You don't see a lot of meat, you don't see a lot of cheese. There's not actually a ton of pizza in the Mediterranean diet, despite the fact that Italy is involved, okay? The focus is on olive oil, nuts, and seeds, him. Those monounsaturated fats are not alone protective against cardiovascular disease, but the Mediterranean diet, you sometimes hear it referred to as a lifestyle, because lifestyle encompasses things besides diet. The slow food movement evolved out of Italy, okay, by an Italian who started the movement. The notion that if we eat more slowly, if we enjoy our food, if meals are something that we focus on instead of eating in our car on our way to work, that's part of a healthier lifestyle. I want to mention avocados. We're here in California. We have access to wonderful avocados. It's avocado season right now. Sometimes people say, well, I don't eat avocados because they're high in fat. But I'd like to show you an example of this is a high-fat food with a really, really admirable nutrition profile. Okay? 1/5 of an avocado is a serving size. That's certainly pretty small, but it has just 50 calories. And while, yes, there's 5 grams of fat in it, it's almost all fat, none of that, or only 1 gram of that, is saturated. Majority of that is monounsaturated and polyunsaturated fats. You see the picture of the peel right there. There's some new data that's actually come out showing that, you know, in addition to being a good source of heart-healthy fats, these avocados are actually very good sources of antioxidants. And so when you peel your avocados, you want to try to preserve as much of the fruit as close to the skin as you can, because we know that the most concentrated source of antioxidants in an avocado is in the flesh that is closest to the skin. As I mentioned, the Mediterranean diet also includes alcohol. We have the criteria there for moderation. The United States recommendations really, they just ignore alcohol. Okay? Americans don't drink alcohol, so they don't just put it in any of their nutrition information. And many people would argue that that's really remiss. If you look at the Harvard Healthy Eating Pyramid, Dr. Walter Willett, a very big proponent of including things that are more akin to the Mediterranean lifestyle in his way of eating than you would see perhaps in some of the USDA things. So again, the focus on alcohol is that it's okay in moderation. People say, well, what if I don't drink? Should I pick it up? Certainly not something you want to pick up as far as getting, you know, some of these heart-healthy benefits. But when we've talked a lot about LDL, but the other side of the equation is our HDL, your good cholesterol level. You know, you can do all these things with diet and exercise to lower your LDL, but what can you do to raise your HDL? There's really only two things we can do outside of medication to raise our good cholesterol. And those are to exercise on a regular basis, okay, so roughly 30 minutes a day, 5 days a week, and also regular and moderate consumption of alcohol can slightly increase your HDL. Again, if you don't drink alcohol, it's not worth picking it up for the 1 to 2 point bump up in your HDL. There's just not a whole lot else we can do. Okay? But note that exercise is a component of both lowering your bad cholesterol as well as increasing your good cholesterol. And I want to leave you just with the 3 studies that we've seen recently really showing us the power of this Mediterranean diet information. Okay? In this study that was published in 2006, and it's the same cohort that was studied that came out in the results that I'll show you next in the big Mediterranean diet study that was published last year. They looked at 722 people who were at high risk for heart disease, and they randomized them to one of 3 groups, a low-fat diet or 2 different types of Mediterranean diets. And what they basically found was that after 3 months, the weight and the BMI of the groups were pretty similar. And yet, the 2 Mediterranean group diets had lower blood sugar, lower blood pressure, and lower better cholesterol outcomes than did the low-fat group. Also, that the inflammation markers, there's some tests that you can do on your blood to show the level of inflammation. The inflammation was lower in the individuals that had the 2 Mediterranean diets. So not only does it help heart disease risk, we know it also helps reduce metabolic syndrome. Remember, that's a cluster of risk factors. It basically is a bunch of bad stuff that combined together can increase your risk of heart disease. In another large study, it looked at following the Mediterranean diet was considered to be extremely protective against the risk of developing metabolic syndrome. Your waist circumference tends to be lower. Your blood sugar tends to be lower. Your blood pressure tends to be lower, and so on and so forth. And then late last year, we had this study, actually earlier this year, in the New England Journal of Medicine. This was the big Mediterranean diet study that really got everyone excited. Because in this case, the researchers looked at more than just outcomes like cholesterol and hypertension and weight. They looked at death. okay? And what they found was that people who were adherents of the Mediterranean diet, the two Mediterranean diet groups, one was heavy on nuts and one was heavy on olive oil, but regardless, both of those groups had a 30% less likely chance of dying from heart attack or stroke or heart disease if they switched to the Mediterranean diet. So again, this is the study that got everyone really excited, because it's you can walk around and not die but have high blood cholesterol. Okay? But if we see that people eating this way are actually dying less frequently, this has really kind of bumped up a lot of focus on the Mediterranean diet, on things like olive oil and avocados and nuts and these other good sources of fat. So in closing, for your own nutrition prescription, you might consider looking at the therapeutic lifestyle change, the TLC diet. This is a diet that has kind of been born out of a lot of peer review and published research, and it shows that basically you want to keep your saturated fat low, your cholesterol low, and your sodium too, okay? As you get older, your blood pressure is creeping up. When you're younger, if you're active and you don't have high blood pressure, you don't really have to worry about your salt. But if you start to develop an affinity for salt, the older you get, the more likely it would be harmful for you to have that high salt diet. And I just want to show you that there is research that this TLC diet works. The combination of lowering your saturated fat, so less meat and cheese, lowering your dietary cholesterol, keeping your weight healthy or losing even just 10 pounds if you're overweight, plus adding soluble fiber and plant stanols and sterols, which we didn't have a chance to talk about. But in conjunction, you can reduce your LDL by 20 to 30%. And that's a more powerful outcome than you see with many of the top line statin drugs, things like Lipitor. They would be proud to show numbers like that. And this is something that you can do before you have to go the route of looking at drugs to help lower your cholesterol. So here's how you determine your lipid needs. We've kind of touched on a number of these. A good number to keep in mind for most people is 65 grams of total fat a day, okay? And we said 20 of those should be saturated. But I really encourage people, if you only can keep one number in your mind, to focus on that number 20. That's the one that if we eat less saturated fat, you'll probably be eating less overall fat and doing yourself a good deal of help with regards to lowering your LDL, okay? You don't need trans fat to live. You can live with 0 grams of trans fat. Remember, those are found in foods like donuts and cakes and cookies that we shouldn't be eating that much of to begin with, okay? I left you with two little calculations that I'm not gonna go into so we can wrap up here. But I did say we get you a nutrition prescription. So there's your basic numbers if you're a numbers person for with regards to how much you'd eat. And then these are I mentioned the meat, the fats. So those are the bad fats on the left there, sat and trans, and the good fats on the right, mono and poly. And if you check out the website, it's geared at the general population, and they have a really nice way of explaining how we can incorporate more of this data that we have about fats into our diet. And then the last couple of slides just contain more information as far as links and other resources for you for some of the topics that we talked about today. So thank you very much for your time.